Guten Morgen, liebe Gäste. Es ist ein großer... Es ist eine große Ehre für mich, heute in Gütersloh zu sein, in der Stadt der Bertelsmann Stiftung. Ich möchte mich besonders bei Liz Mohn für die Einladung bedanken, im Andenken an ihren Mann Reinhard Mohn und auch dafür, dass ich einem meiner Idole, Klaus Schwab, hier eine besondere Anerkennung erweisen kann. Entschuldigen Sie mein schlechtes Deutsch. Ich habe es nur... Ich habe es nur in kurzer Zeit in der Gymnasium gelernt. Actually, I wanted to say that I was going to speak more German until I saw the theme of the meeting today, and I just could not handle verantwortungsvolles Unternehmertum. But I do want to say that the Mohn Prize and Award is very special and close to my heart, as it honors an individual who contributes to the public welfare, participation, and sustainable social progress in such an enormously important way. I'd like to thank the Bertelsmann Foundation, and particularly Liz Mohn, who's become a friend over the last few years, inviting me here today. But I also want to thank Liz for putting this prize together. It's been given for almost 20 years, that highlights the significant contributions of an individual in this very particular way. It's of course named after a giant in the world of business, Reinhard Mohn. And as you all know, he was a self-made man. He was modest. He rode his bike to the office here in Gütersloh. He ate in the company canteen. And he gave company shares to his workers, which was very unusual at the time. In response to his critics who couldn't understand why he would do such a thing, he would say that his workers were far more important than his share price. He transformed his family business from a 19th century printer of Protestant Bibles into one of the most influential media corporations in the world. But one of the most lasting achievements of Reinhard Mohn is related to the theme today of responsible entrepreneurship. Over the last few decades, there's been much talk and scholarship and debate, of course, around the role of corporations in making the world a better place. The conversation began many years ago with the notion of corporate charity. It evolved into a discussion focused on corporate social responsibility, but then now there are other ways of conceiving the issue. My good friend and former colleague from Harvard Business School, Michael Porter, has built a vibrant community of practice around the notion of shared value. But in preparing for this event, I was really inspired to learn that Reinhard Mohn, well ahead of his time, was constantly pushing himself and his contemporaries in the corporate world to do what they could to make the world a better place. His approach was rather unique. It was through the lens of the individual, and how society, including the private sector, could allow a person to reach her or his full potential. In his view, social participation, meaning the opportunities that each individual has to develop within society, required responsible, capable individuals on the one hand, and on the other, a society and business community that would create those opportunities and encourage people to take action. That's why it's so appropriate that we're honoring today Klaus Schwab, a visionary whose efforts quite literally have led to some of the most important breakthroughs and innovations in our world today. Many of these innovations have led to the direct opening up of possibilities for people, often very, very poor people in very remote parts of the world, who never could have dreamed of achieving their aspirations without the openings that happened at the World Economic Forum. Klaus's view, which he outlined in seminal papers in the years in which he was a business school professor, was that no sector within the global system can single-handedly manage the greatest global challenges. governments, businesses, civil society, academia, and foundation need each other to tackle effectively the most important and complex problems. His brilliance has rested in his faith that the world would find solutions if there was a true partnership across a broad spectrum of state and non-state actors. The World Economic Forum today, of course, is iconic, but it wasn't always so. Here is Klaus with the leaders of Greece and Turkey. And at this meeting, the two nations came to an agreement that allowed them to avoid war. Here he is, and I don't need to tell you who these people are, but in 1989, they had discussions at Davos about German reunification. In 1992, South African President F.W. de Klerk, Chief Mangosuthu Buthelezi, and the recently released from prison Nelson Mandela met with Klaus and sat on a podium for the first time in history. Here, and this is a truly tragic photo because we know what happened afterwards, Shimon Peres and PLO chairman, of course, Yasser Arafat, reached a draft agreement on Gaza and Jericho. What would have happened if that had actually come into force? And this is the Klaus that I know. Now, I just want to tell you a couple of stories about how important Klaus has been for me and the world. But the story actually starts, can you all hear me? I hope you can still. The story starts with Lismon and Bertelsmann Stiftung. A few years ago, I was invited to an event to talk about climate change in Berlin. And on the panel with me was Nicholas von Baumhardt of Munich Re. And Nicholas and I started a conversation, and that conversation stuck in my head. What he told me was essentially the reinsurance industry has a stake in preventing really bad things from happening. They have a stake in preventing climate change. They have a stake in preventing other things, and the idea began to sift into my head that maybe they have a stake in preventing pandemics. And so the idea stuck in my head, and then, of course, there was the tragedy of Ebola. And when Ebola happened, it was, at first, completely under the radar. This started in December of 2013, the first cases. And then in January, February, March, the cases began to grow. Now, I'm the president of the World Bank. We do not respond to Ebola outbreaks. When I was at the World Health Organization, of course, we would have. But in this case, I wasn't paying attention because truly this wasn't my job. And then in about July, I began to hear stories about how the disease was spreading and spreading very, very quickly. And so I began to call some people, and my colleagues who were in the infectious disease world said, Jim, this is the worst outbreak we have ever seen. There is so much Ebola out there. And I kept looking around and saying, well, where's the response? Where's the response? As of early August of 2014, 9 months after the start of the outbreak, there was no money pledged to really tackle the issue. So the World Bank was the first organization to pledge money. We pledged $400 million. But it was too late. And by the time all of the money started moving, it was already October of 2014, and we had a huge problem on our hands. And so afterwards, I began to think about, well, so how could we prevent this problem from happening again? And I began talking to Nicholas von Baumhardt and Michel Lies from Swiss Re, and they said, look, it is in our interest, because in fact, if a 1918-style flu pandemic were to happen again, we would lose 30-plus million lives and potentially 5% of global GDP. That's $4 trillion. And their specific interest, other than being humanitarians, their specific interest is that not only did they hold the life insurance policies, but even more importantly, they held the business disruption policies. In other words, pandemics, and we saw this in SARS, we saw this with Ebola, trade stops in those areas. And with broad pandemics, trade would stop everywhere. And so they would be liable for paying the business disruption policy claims. Now, I said, can we think of something like this? Can we can we do a bond? Can we do an insurance policy? And they said, well, you know, it's difficult, but every new insurance industry is difficult. The automobile industry was difficult to begin with. We didn't know that seatbelts were helpful. We didn't know that shoulder harnesses were even more helpful. We didn't know that airbags were even more helpful and speed bumps more helpful yet. We didn't know that, but it was research that the insurance industry did along with consumers, because the interest of the insurance industry and the interest of consumers to stay safe were aligned. Now, I didn't know how to bring people together, because insurance industry executives don't talk to global health leaders. And so I went to Klaus, and this is what I admire most about Klaus. Klaus is so brilliant that even if he doesn't know the details, if there's an idea that sounds like it has promise, he responds. So he said, let's do an eGWEL. I didn't know what an eGWEL was. It's a funny name, but it's I-G-W-E-L. It's an international gathering of world economic leaders, and it doesn't happen anywhere else. You get into a room, it's all completely confidential, and you get to sit and think about the world's most difficult problems. And in that room, in the eGWEL, in Davos, for the first time, I think, in history, we had private sector people, we had the insurance industry, we had leaders from the Gates Foundation, we had Margaret Chan from the World Health Organization, and we discussed this issue, and the insurance industry executives explained that they could potentially insure us against the spreading of a pandemic. At that moment, there were several aha moments that happened around the room in that eGWEL. I'm very, very proud to say that as a result of that meeting and the continued persistence, thanks to Liz, thanks to Bertelsmann, thanks to Klaus, at the Isashima Summit just this past May, we were able to announce that for the first time in history, we will have a pandemic insurance policy. Now, what that means is that we'll have three parts. There'll be a cash window to tackle. You know, this cash window would have been available in December and January when Ebola started. We potentially could have put it out in three villages. But if it grows, the insurance policy would have released at least $100 million by July instead of having to wait till October. And from July to October, the Ebola epidemic grew tenfold. So this is a very different kind of insurance policy. I didn't know they existed. There's claims-based insurance, which you pay after the fact, but then there's something called parametric insurance, which releases when certain conditions have been met. I didn't even know that they had this, and I would not have known if I had not been lucky enough to meet these wonderful people. And so, for the first time in history, we're going to have a cash window, we're going to have an actual insurance policy, and we've even found that we can sell pandemic bonds. Everyone, all the investors in the world are looking for return so aggressively that we found tremendous interest in the pandemic bond that we'll put on the table. Now, just all those elements, pandemic outbreaks, Ebola, insurance, pandemic bonds, all that world doesn't come together anywhere except in Davos. Excuse me. This is a picture from Klaus's extremely important book entitled The Fourth Industrial Revolution. Now, I want to read you a few messages from there because they're just so important. When I went, this was just this year, 2016, the Fourth Industrial Revolution, and the book says these kinds of things, and I quote, "We have yet to grasp fully the speed and breadth of this new revolution. Consider the unlimited possibilities of having billions of people connected by mobile devices, giving rise to unprecedented processing power, storage capabilities, and knowledge access. Or think about the staggering confluence of emerging technology breakthroughs covering wide-ranging fields such as artificial intelligence, robotics, the Internet of Things, autonomous vehicles, 3D printing, nanotechnology, biotechnology, material science, energy storage, and quantum computing, to name a few. Many of these innovations are in their infancy, but they're already reaching an inflection point in their development as they build on and amplify each other in a fusion of technologies across the physical and digital world." And as we know, it's already happening.
Three of the world's 10 largest employers, this is not from the book, are already replacing tens of thousands of their workers with robots. Foxconn, a key manufacturing partner for Apple, Google, and Amazon, has already replaced 60,000 workers with robots. Walmart, the third largest global employer with 2.1 million workers, wants to replace its warehouse stock checkers with flying drones that can scan miles of shelves in a fraction of the time. Citi and Oxford University predict that 77% of all jobs in China and 57% of all jobs in the 34 OECD countries are at risk from automation. And so this was, not, again, Klaus's great brilliance is that he didn't just celebrate this. This was not just a celebration of technology and increased productivity. He wrote this, and this is what really had an impact on me. The changes are so profound from the perspective of human history, there has never been a time of greater promise or potential peril. My concern, however, is that decision makers are too often caught in traditional, linear, and non-disruptive thinking, are too absorbed by immediate concerns to think strategically about the forces of disruption and innovation shaping our future. Well, I took this very, very seriously, and I asked myself, should Klaus be concerned about me? Am I thinking in traditional ways? Is the World Bank thinking in traditional ways about what we do to prepare developing countries and poor people in the world for this future? Well, I began thinking about a particular phenomenon, which is childhood stunting. Childhood stunting is very simple. We measure children's height and compare it to the average. And a child we consider stunted if they're two standard deviations below the average. But what's really interesting now, and what has changed, we've always known that there is childhood stunting in the world. But it's only recently that we've begun to understand the full implications of childhood stunting on the development of the human brain. On the left is a typical brain cell with extensive branching. What we know now, and this is a word that did not even exist when I was in medical school, the most important part of your neuroanatomy is your connectome. In other words, the most important part is how your neurons are connected to each other. A developing child is building literally tens of thousands of connections every day, all the time. And what happens is in a stunted child here on the right, they don't have those connections. They actually don't have the physical connections that they need to learn, to continue to learn, and eventually to earn. And so I went back to the economists at the World Bank Group, and I said, why have we not focused more on stunting? Because guess what? 25% of all children in the world today are stunted. India, 38.6% stunting. Pakistan, 45% stunting. The Democratic Republic of the Congo, 70% stunting. Guatemala, in the Western Hemisphere, Guatemala, 52% stunting. When I went to Indonesia and saw President Joko Widodo, I said to him, do you know what the stunting rate is in your country? And do you know what it means? And he said no to both questions. And I told him, you are a rising upper middle income country. You aspire to be a high income country. You have 37% of your children who are stunted. That means 37% of your future workforce may not be able to compete in the digital world that Klaus has described. Now, once again, looking around the world and wondering how we're going to attack this, I immediately went to Klaus. And at first, Klaus said, but, you know, what's the issue here, Jim? And, you know, are these just short kids? Does this matter? And when I explained it to him, he got it right away and said, we've got to do something about this. So here's what I want to do. For years and years and years, leaders have known that stunted children are not a good thing. But now we know that it's potentially a disastrous thing, but disastrous probably only in the next 5 to 10 to 15 years for them. But we're going to announce every year at Davos the stunting rates in the world. And the other good news is, while we haven't been able to make progress on stunting before, in 2007 we discovered a method to quickly reduce stunting, and it is all about incentives. We give cash transfers to women but only if the previous month they did those things to keep their children healthy. And we give money to countries that then gives money to healthcare systems, but only if they get the outcomes. It's results-based financing, and it had a dramatic impact. Peru reduced the stunting rate from 28%, and it had been at 28 to 30%. I've worked there for years, for decades, and they'd been trying to affect it, and they could not. With this new incentive-based approach, they went from 28% to 14% in just 7 years. We're gonna do that all over the world, and we're gonna do it at Davos, because we want leaders and ministers of finance to know that if they don't take action on it, they may lose foreign direct investment because all the investors are in Davos. And they also, their borrowing costs might even go up. Never before have we had a way of properly incentivizing leaders to take care of their children. And it would not have happened, I don't think it will happen, unless we had a place where the private sector and the public sector come together and they look at what's happening in each other's fields. Now, the importance of Klaus and his work, I think it's just hard to overstate. In anthropology, we talk about social cynosures, people who are so bright that people pay attention, people have an interest, and Klaus brings people together. So the forum of Davos is so important, but it's only important because Klaus and Hilde have been able to keep people together. The way they do it is just amazing. I don't know if I've been able to watch it up close for the last few years, and it's just extraordinary how people from diametrically opposed views of very different worlds are brought together at this forum. And to understand why I think Davos, the World Economic Forum, Klaus, and Hilde are going to become even more important for the future, all we need to do is read from the words of Nelson Mandela in 1992 in that photo. Excuse me, let me just go through here. At that meeting in 1992, this is what Nelson Mandela said. "I'm certain that it's a matter of common cause among us here that the continued impoverishment of millions of people throughout the world has become one of the great sources of global instability. Those who are deprived will inevitably act to demand a better life. The point we're trying to make is that the dire poverty of some is not an affliction which impacts only on those who are deprived. It reverberates across the globe and ineluctably impacts negatively on the whole of humanity, including those who live in conditions of comfort and plenty. The inescapable conclusion from all this must surely be that our interdependence, bringing us together into a common global home across the oceans and the continents, demands that we all combine to launch a global offensive for development, prosperity, and human survival." I think that that cannot happen with governments alone. If you look at all the official development assistance available today, about $140 billion, nowhere near enough to meet the demands and desires of everyone in the world to lead a good life. You know, everywhere I've gone, the one thing that's been so striking to me is that since everyone has smartphones, everyone knows how everyone else lives. There's a reason that refugees are willing to take to boats to get to Germany. There's a reason that every single person in the world is ready to demonstrate, take to the streets, because they want what everyone else seems to have. The only way we're going to solve this problem is if we take whatever grant-based funding is available, leverage it with loans that we can get, and then with that, leverage the private sector. Where else are we going to have that discussion except at Davos? And because Davos happens every year, we can hold ourselves accountable. Let me just end with a quote from one of my favorite writers and thinkers, Goethe. And I think Goethe most perfectly illustrates both the life of Reinhard Mohn and the life of Klaus Schwab. Goethe said, "The moment one definitely commits oneself, then providence moves too. All sorts of things occur to help one that would never otherwise have occurred. A whole stream of events issues from the decision, raising in one's favor all manner of unforeseen incidents and meetings and material assistance, which no man could have dreamed would have come his way. Whatever you can do or dream you can dream, begin it. Boldness has genius, power, and magic in it. Begin it now. Reinhard Mohn and Klaus Schwab have given us that gift of boldness, of opening up opportunities, and in the case of the World Bank and my work, has opened up paths so that we can truly lift everyone out of extreme poverty. Thank you very much.